Welcome home.
It sure is good to see you all tonight. You don't know how much I mean that. It's been quite a few days that we've had, and your prayers and the good Lord has got us through this. So we thank you from the bottom of our heart. You've always been a praying people. We came here because of that. And I've wondered, you know, at times if we may have lost that. But you've proven to me through the last couple of weeks that we haven't lost it. Amen. You're a people who go to your knees in prayer and call on the good Lord and He answers. Amen. And you've moved mountains by faith in the last couple of weeks. And so our presence and the presence of the folks that are going to come up here on this stage tonight are a testament to your faithfulness and the good Lord's grace and mercy on our church and on our lives. So we thank you. We want to do the service a little bit different tonight. We want to mention a couple of things specifically. We want to pray for the family of Scott Lawhorn and the loss, a church member, Rick Murdaugh, critically injured early Saturday morning in a car accident off Highway 200 near his home. He's currently at ICU at UF Shands. So we want to pray for them. And then we want to pray for the family of Scott, and those funeral services will be at Living Water Church on Saturday at 3 p.m. And so before we talk about how we made it and we are here to tell the story, we're going to talk about those that the good Lord called home. We're going to pray for them. So can we take a moment and just do what we do every Wednesday night in this church and just have a prayer meeting real quick? Let's pray together. Father, we bow before you, and Lord, we lift up these that are hurting tonight, these that are mourning tonight. God, as a church that prays, we believe that even as we call upon your name tonight, that you're there in their presence and you're making yourself manifest to them. Comforting, Lord, where comfort is needed. Healing, where healing is needed. Sustaining, giving patience, giving endurance. Showing them, Lord, that all things work together for good to those who love the Lord and who are the called according to His purpose. And so tonight, Father, we lift them up to you. And we pray for your divine mercy on their life. And God, that you would let us be your arms and legs in their life, God, just to minister to these families as they need it. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, we're going to tell you a story, but let me invite our friends up here. If you went with us on the Israel trip, if you suffered through the Hamas war, I guess I could say, come on up here tonight. And let's we may have to pull a couple of seats out of the choir if we don't have enough, but we should have enough. Y'all just make your way on up. We're just going to walk through. I'm going to walk through, and we should have a mic for each row. And we're just going to kind of walk through quickly the experience that we've been through. We've told this to news reporters and Inside Edition called, ABC News, CNN, Fox. Our local coverage has been the best right here in Jacksonville, and even our newspaper was very, very kind to us, and we appreciate that. And they really rallied support for people from right here in the hometown. And so, but you're our family, and so we want to tell you the full story and some things maybe that we didn't share with them, and give everybody an opportunity just to share kind of what the Lord's put on your heart and give you an opportunity to ask questions if you have it in the time that we have. Now, if you're new to Wednesday night, I am a stickler that we land the plane at 7 o'clock, okay? So if we're not going to try to be ugly and cut it off, you know, in the middle of a sentence, but just be aware of that, that if we don't get to your question, we'll hang around and talk to you after, okay? So our trip began the way most trips like this do. We landed in Tel Aviv, and then we were transported to our hotel. It was a great, beautiful hotel in Netanya, Israel. And we began to settle into the routine of how things go and considering which sites we're going to visit and getting our agendas all worked out. From Netanya, the next day, we began our journey north toward the Sea of Galilee, and we stopped at a few places along the way. Now, you might correct me. My timeline is a mess. Are you guys still jet lagged at all? How's everybody feeling? We had some that came home a little bit sick, and then we've jet lag and all that stuff. It's just been a crazy, crazy few days. But this is the way I remembered it. As we came back, I went toward Galilee. We stopped at several different biblical sites, Herod's palace in Caesarea by the sea. We drove to Mount Carmel, where Elijah called fire down from heaven on the altar. We saw the Valley of Megiddo, where one of those great and final battles will be fought. Over in the distance, you could see the little village of Nazareth, which in its day only had a couple of hundred inhabitants, but today it's like the third or fourth largest city in Israel. And we realized, just as we looked over that landscape, that the boy Jesus, as he grew up in that city, would play and overlook the Valley of Armageddon, knowing what's going to happen there one day. And there were many moments like that where it just clicked that, wow, you know, the Bible just does really come alive when you're in that area. The next day we went and toured that city of Nazareth. We saw the cliff where they were going to throw Jesus off, and he passed through the crowd that we studied in the book of Luke just a little bit ago. We traveled to the far north. We visited Tel Dan. It was a place I'd never been before. But from there, our guide pointed out the fences that signified the border with Lebanon. We could have thrown a rock into Lebanon. We could have stepped into Lebanon. We were that close. And little did we know that just a few days later, troops would begin to amass along that border and tanks trying to keep out attacks from Hezbollah. Then we reached the point in our tour where we did a sail on the Sea of Galilee. And many of you have gone with us before and you've experienced that. You're in a large boat. They show you how they catch the fish. It was a grand, grand time. We have a video showing that they even got the Baptist to dance while we were there. If you noticed, I wasn't in that group. I said, dancing's for the Presbyterians, you know, but while we were there, I had a few moments to teach. And you know, there are things that you're kind of go-to text when you're in those kind of places. And we've done it five times. This was our fifth trip to Israel. So I broke out my notes from the Sea of Galilee, and I began to teach about Jesus calming the storm. Now, if you remember that story, a violent storm arose. They were out in one of those little fishing boats, and the disciples were in fear for their life. They were terrified. They were in the grip of fear, and Jesus was asleep in the bow of the boat, and so they woke Jesus up, and these are fishermen who knew a safe condition and an unsafe condition on that sea. They woke Jesus up, and they said, "Lord, we're perishing," and he woke up, and he spoke to the storm, and he said, "Hush, be still." And it obeyed like an obedient child. It just became perfectly calm. And as fascinating as that was, it was the verse that followed that we really camped out on. It was the fact that the disciples then were again gripped with fear, not by the storm, but by the one who could calm the storm. And we said that the person who was in the boat, Jesus, was greater than the storm. But little did we know the storm that we were about to walk into. We went back to the dock, got off our boat, and I figured we were heading toward the museum where they had unearthed a first century vessel, a boat, from the time of Jesus. They call it the Jesus boat. You can go on YouTube and watch videos about it. It's a great thing to see. But we didn't. The tour guide was leading us toward our buses. And as we made our way toward the buses, I pulled him aside and I said, are we not going to go to the museum? And he said, well, Pastor, they've closed the museum because of something that's happened on the Gaza border. That's the first that we heard about it. You all were in bed when that happened. But they said, something has happened on the Gaza border. There's been some attacks and we don't know exactly what all happened. But I said, you know, find out what you can, verify what you can. He began to talk to his family in Jerusalem, and we got more and more details. We got on board the bus, and we briefed you guys about what had happened, the best we knew and the best that we could explain. And from there, we weren't really sure what we were dealing with. We didn't know if it would be a skirmish that would die down in a day or two or something more significant. But once we had informed everybody, we shot a brief video, mostly for you guys here in our church, so that when you woke up and you began to see the social media, you wouldn't be alarmed. And so this is the video that we posted soon after that.
Hey guys, Pastor Zach here. Just wanted to give you a word for Israel. We're touring here in Israel, here near Tiberias. We're actually at the McDonald's site currently. We're about 2 hours away from any of the danger that you're reading about and hearing about on the news. We just wanted you to know that we're okay. We wanted to ask you to pray for us, to pray for Israel, to pray for this to end quickly, and for the Lord's will, this is a conquer to be done here in this land. And so if you would, could we just pray together now? Father, we bow before you. We lift up these precious people and this land that is so special to us and special in our history. Father, we pray that you would bring a quick end to this conflict. And Father,
a couple of days later, that had about 40,000 views. It went all over the place. Across our nation, I received a email from a church in Bangkok that was praying for us. Wow. And just how that happened is somewhat inexplicable and why it happened. But it did, and the next morning, it was evident that the war was imminent. Flights had begun to cancel in Tel Aviv, and we had to make a decision whether we would hunker down there in Tiberias, which was near Hezbollah territory, or whether we would move toward Jerusalem, which was about an hour and a half to 2 hours from the Gaza territory and Hamas. We believed that we would be able, until we could arrange the flight, so we would be safer in Jerusalem because it was near the embassy. And so we decided to travel down to our hotels in Jerusalem. Now, entering into Jerusalem, there's a tunnel that you have to drive through, and the tour guides and the bus drivers, they know exactly when to play a certain song about the glory of Jerusalem. And right as you pull out of that tunnel and you see the Temple Mount for the first time, the beautiful city of Jerusalem, the song is at its climax, and it's just a glorious experience. Little compares to that experience, and especially for the first time, which it was the first time for many of our people. We made our way there to the Mount of Olives, and we overlooked the city, and we stood in the place that one day Scripture tells us Christ will return, and that mountain will be split in half. But this time it was different, because as we read the Scripture, as we took in the landscape, over in the west, you could see smoke faintly. It wasn't clear and obvious, but in the distance you could see smoke. And we had a photograph there. And if you look closely in the photograph, you can see some over to the far left of kind of what we would see. But that's our group. That's right after we arrived in Jerusalem. We drove from there to our hotel. And with each, you know, at first it was each day things were kind of going to a new level. Now it was like each hour. And so as we made our way to our hotel, we came up to an intersection. We noticed police lights and several cars pulled over. We're from, you know, this area. We thought it was just a traffic jam. We felt like we were in Yulee, you know. And so, honestly, didn't have a clue. We were like frustrated, like, oh my goodness, this is just going to slow us down. And then we started noticing the ladies getting out of their cars and covering their heads and ducking down. Our bus driver was about to evacuate our bus, and he opened up our door. We could hear the sirens. And apparently, some of the missiles had been lobbed into Jerusalem, and a couple had gotten through, and the sirens were going off. And the reality, I think, at that moment of what we were in the middle of began to take hold. We made our way to the hotel. I think we have an image of that, of the stop. Of, they didn't want you to take many pictures, so we didn't have a lot, but we got a few along the way just to show some of what we went through. But we made our way to the hotel. We learned so much about how Israel defends itself and how the Iron Dome system works. And the best way I can describe it to you is when Hamas fires a missile, they fire a barrage of missiles. They fire like 25 or 30. And those missiles are relatively cheap. I don't know the exact price on those missiles, what it costs to produce them, but just so you can understand, it's like a $100 missile that they're lobbing over. It's not an intelligent missile. It's not a smart missile. It doesn't know where it's going to land. It's just sent in that direction toward Jerusalem, and it falls where it will. That's why so many have exploded. You've heard about the hospital and how I can very easily see that that was a Hamas missile, because that's just the nature of what they're working with over there. The Israeli missiles, on the other hand, are very expensive. They're like $1,000 missiles. So you have $25, $100 missiles coming at them. You've got a retaliation of the Iron Dome, $1,000 missiles. And so what that system does, very quickly, it determines where each of those $100 missiles are going to land. It calculates the trajectory. And then it asks, are there people there? And if there are people there, it sends up an interceptor to detonate that missile to protect human life. But if there are no people there, if the missile is going to land in a field or a parking lot, it will let the missile come on through, because it's not worth $1,000 when it's not going to hurt anybody anyway. So that's the simple version of how that the Iron Dome system works. And apparently a couple of the missiles had landed relatively close to where we were at. And then the next day, they were even closer. We got to our hotel and took stock of everything that we were experiencing. We continued to post videos, but we began to be aware that it wasn't wise to let people know where we were. So when you saw a video, typically we were well removed from that location when you saw it. I would upload it after we left the location. We began that next day to have the news outlets contacting us, reporters from papers and television, radio, and the last thing I wanted to do was worry about all the tech that was required to do those interviews. There was just a lot. It was constant, just set up and meeting with people and working things out. But it occurred to me that coverage can be leveraged to get us out of there. That if we get the coverage and if enough eyes are on that situation, the airlines are going to be motivated to work with us. Our tour company, they needed to see that people are watching this. Future clients are watching this. And they did. And they did a tremendous job to come through to help us get out of there. Cost them a lot to get us out of there. But, from that point, our on Congressman Aaron Bean reached out. He was texting with us all through it and giving us instructions on how to work with the State Department and the embassy there in Jerusalem, and giving us all the resources that they had to help. Marco Rubio's office reached out and made their resources available. Governor Kemp from Georgia contacted us. We had a Georgia senator on the trip, Russ Goodman. And so Governor Kemp made sure we had someone who had a direct connection to the Israeli intelligence, Mossad. We had a lady very highly connected with Mossad who could tell us if we were in a very dangerous situation and if we needed to relocate. So, you know, we had so many people that were just rallying around us and helping us and giving us instruction and advice, and we were trying to filter through it. One thing that we learned about Americans is whatever is happening over there gets over here, it gets amped up about 10 times, and then it comes back to us. So things you guys were telling us, we just kind of had to filter as we could, because sometimes we would tell our bus driver, we'd tell our tour guide, and he would go, that video was from a war 10 years ago. That didn't even happen this week. Things people would send to us. And so it was like, oh my goodness, getting good information is difficult. Fake news travels really fast. So we were, you know, felt like we had a lot of people helping us and so many praying for us. The travel company found accommodations in Jordan, and they believed they could secure us flights out of Jordan. But even if they couldn't, it would be safer, we believed, to be in Jordan and out of, you know, the war zone. So we began to move into Jordanian territory, and as we made our way closer to the border, the first border crossing closed just before we got there. And then we went down to the next one, and thank God it was open. We went through at that checkpoint. We went through all of the process. It was about a four-hour wait because nobody's prepared for that. We have a video of the crowd gathered there outside the Jordanian border. You see every race, every nationality. Well, that didn't give you the up view, but there was hundreds, maybe thousands of people gathered there trying to get through, all had the same idea that we did. We waited there about 4 hours, prayed that the rain wouldn't start, and eventually through language barriers and all the things you deal with, we finally were allowed to enter into Jordan. As the sun set, we were driving through Jordanian towns, and in these big buses, people began to fill the streets. And that was probably the most frightened that I was in the whole trip. I didn't say anything, but here we are, a bunch of Americans, the lights were on in the bus, and you had Jordanians lining the streets that looked like they were curious who we were. Well, I found out later that was just their custom. That's what they do. It's so hot. It's a desert region, and they can't really have community during the day, so they come outside at night. There's little kids playing outside at night. There's many adult, you know, guys out at night. And so there wasn't any threat. That was just what they do in any given evening. And so we made our way to Amman, stayed there a night, and then from Amman, we relocated down to the Dead Sea area, and we stayed there, was it 3 days or 4 days? How long were we in? Some of us were 3 days, some of us were 4 days. People began to secure flights, and if they could get a flight, we let them, you go ahead and take that, you know, because we don't know, what you never knew when everything was going to fall through. So as people could get out, they did. We would get them to the airport and just, you know, trust the process. The Jordanian airport, by the way, was very helpful. They gave us someone to just get us through all of that each time we sent somebody. And so each day we had a group of like 25, and then the next group of 30 going through at a time. And then thankfully, as all those flights opened up, we made our long trek and we got back home. And it was so good to get back and to see everybody. And so that's just kind of a broad overview of our time. Now, if you'll look, there's mics on each end. And I want to give you all just an opportunity, if anybody just has a thought that they want to just kind of fill in the gaps now of things they'd like to add. Ed? That's on.
We're on. Thank you. Two things. First, a praise. During that time, we had to pivot for our baptism. And we had over 20 baptism, many of them renewals, but praise for the three first-timers. So I want to make sure that we celebrate that.
Amen.
Yeah,
amen.
Amen. I will tell you, there was probably four times that I was a little nervous, never told Christy here, but I want to just, part of scripture I go to is Psalms 27, and the Lord is my light and my salvation. And boy, did I say that every second. I bet I said that 1,000 times. Once we saw where we stopped, and actually the sirens went off on our bus because we all downloaded an app called Homefront, recommended if you travel, recommend that you register stuff yourself at the U.S. Embassy, no matter what country you go to, because that's your go-to safe net to get information. But that was probably one of the times. But I want to celebrate that when we started, where Paul confessed faith of Jesus Christ as Caesarian, and then we moved down backwards through the New Testament to Jerusalem, the Bible coming alive and crossing into Jordan. Not many people get to do the Old Testament. Mm. And so we ended in the Old Testament. And to stand on the mountain, to look over and see what Moses saw, which was the Promised Land, was probably most impressive to me. It was breathtaking. So
we had, a lot of you had asked to do that. And there were some political things going on between Israel and Jordan. And if you went into Jordan, Israel didn't want to let you back in. So we opted to not do that part of the trip, but then we got to anyways. That was kind of a cool little, you know, not to say in anything that we, there. Here's the weird thing about life. It's paradigmatic. There are things that happen that you hate, but at the same time, some really interesting things come about. And life's just that way, is it not? I mean, who would ever wish for this war? That's insane. But at the same time, in the middle of that war, God did some amazing things. And so it's hard to even talk about it sometimes, but you got to hear it with that in mind, that the Lord did do some amazing things through this. And through it, I think it was Mary Goltz, she mentioned at some point, reminded us that the one that's in the boat is bigger than the storm. And so this, that reminder that, you know, Jesus is king. He's sovereign over all the universe. And nothing's going to happen to us that doesn't get through his providence. And so just resting in that and allowing the Lord to speak to us and work in our lives, it was very important. And we really noticed that he took advantage of those opportunities to grow us through it. Who else?
Early on in the trip, my husband said, "You're awfully quiet." And I reminded him that I'm extra. But in Israel, it was not the place to be extra. I talked to God before I left. I apologized in advance that I was so excited to be where Jesus walked. And I apologized because I said, "Lord, I know you're not any closer there than you are right here." But there, when you're not bombarded with all the regular things, you have a chance to listen and just be in his presence. And I will say, through the whole ordeal, we had 2 days that were pretty hairy. And I remember texting my congressman and saying, "Okay, I'm ready to come home now." And I think that was after we had visited in Magdala. We had visited a church that's on top of the synagogue where the woman touched Jesus's prayer shawl. And it was dark. and really quiet and gloomy that evening. But that moment was beautiful. And we came out, and there's a snake crawling in front of the church. And he stops and coils up, I think because we were there and we were scaring him. But the fighter jets were then flying over, but it was cloudy, so we couldn't see. We could only hear it. And the weight of it was really heavy. But I know for me, I knew every second that God knew exactly what was going to happen. And I have to say, I didn't know if that meant we were getting out or we were getting hit by a rocket. But I was confident in the fact that whatever it was going to be the right thing.
Amen. So witnessing opportunities with some of our interviews, they would ask, you know, your people didn't seem like they were, you know, too concerned. And I said, well, they were ready. And he said, ready for what? And I said, to meet their maker. And he went, oh. So if the worst case scenario is you die, right? And we believe in a God of resurrection. And so we've said it many times that there's nothing that can happen to you that a good resurrection won't fix. And it was true. It was true in the moment.
So, first off, thank you for all your prayers. They were definitely felt. And the impact was not just here. I mean, Pastor Zach mentioned Bangkok. You're talking a big reach here. But it's in the community. I called to postpone a visit to advanced therapy. And they said, oh, are you part of that group? The whole office has been praying for you. So we found that time after time, business contacts I have in D.C., Texas, Illinois, Michigan, folks I didn't even know who knew the word prayer said, we're praying for you for your safe return. Tell us more when you get back. So there's this big reach. And sometimes you take these trips, you kind of feel like it's just for us, right? This is a vacation. This is something that we're just going to do to make us feel better. But this one was much different and had a much different impact. And I'm sure we'll be talking about it for quite a while. We did have a little bit of fun with this group. You're not going to not have fun. One of the things we did is we actually developed a little bit of a playlist for the group. Pastor Zach started off by bringing up this totally non-scriptural, spiritual, is Hotel California. You can check out any time you like, but you can never leave. My favorite was Three Dog Night. Mama told me not to come. Then, I think it was Bill Roden developed, came up with Bon Jovi, Living on a Prayer. Let's see, Ed Jackson came up with Tom Petty's Refugee. Angie's favorite, because I get a lot of nodding heads here, was Shoe Fly, Don't Bother Me. And then my favorite, even as we came to New York City, almost back in the U.S., was Merle Haggard and Big City, Turn Me Loose and Set Me Free.
The flies he's talking about. We got down to the area where they believe Sodom and Gomorrah had been. When we opened the bus door, it was swarming with flies. And that was interesting. I don't recommend you visit there. Just take my word for it. It's not a real fun tourist site, but those flies were with us till we, I think maybe when we landed at Jack's, it was a little better. And then it was the no-see-ums, right? So, Rich.
My brother contacted me and said, how you doing? And I said, well, to paraphrase Die Hard, come to Israel, we'll hang out, have a few laughs. That was the approach I took with him. The approach I took with me was a little more scriptural, and that was Psalm 71, verse 18. Spare me when I'm old and gray, that I may share your strength and power with the next generation. Mm. So I pondered that as we thought about where are we going to have the opportunity to share a message with the next generation?
Amen. Amen.
I would like to share that I was the only one who was by myself in the room. So everybody was in pairs or husbands, couples. And so I have to share that from the very beginning when I was going on the plane, somebody that was not a Christian sat next to me and began to talk all over about his God. And I had to tell him that my God was Jesus. And when I said that, he said, yes, I know. And then he finally became quiet. But he was all over, like people actually worry about it. Like, what was he bothering you? I say, in a certain way, yes. He was just telling me that his God was my God and that we all the same. And he was going on and on. So, but my God is Jesus. And I told him that. And he said, yes, I know that. But then he got quiet. He didn't speak to me anymore, which was great. So I went, I have to say that I had so much peace during the whole time, although I was by myself, because I was surrounded by everybody who was watching to see where I was. And they make sure that I was always within the group, because sometimes I wonder just to take pictures, because I like to take pictures. So, and sometimes I did, but they were like, where's Leandra? Where's Leandra? And there she is. So I would come back. So I felt very secure with my group. People asked me if I was doing okay, you know, and all of that. So I felt the presence of God the whole time. And I have to say the guide that we had, I felt like he was in such touch with Jesus that he knew where he could keep us safe. I have to say that because I feel that. I feel that, that Jesus was with him at all time. So it was different when we went to Jordan with our, we had to be separated into two buses, and I was in the smaller bus in the back, and somehow our conversations were not the same. You know, sometimes I feel a little bit uncertain. You know, I hope that this guy doesn't get angry and just leave us here in Jordan or something, because I was, it was not the same in Jordan as it was in Israel. So I have to say that God kept us safe when we were in Bethlehem, and we were in the shepherd's field watching that. I began to feel like drip drops, and the drip drops began to get bigger. And it was overcast, so you couldn't see the sky, but you could hear the sounds of what I knew what it was, because I do have family in Panama who kept me informed of everything from the beginning. So I was a little bit afraid of when, no, I wasn't afraid, but I was thinking that we should just go back to the hotel at that time, and it was what happened. We went back to the hotel, and I was sitting next to Carol, and she's very nice and calm, and it was wonderful to sit next to her. And at one time, she did see a man, right, that was kneeling, and he was like with his hands over his head, like covered up. And she said, look at that man. And I looked, and it felt weird, but what I told Carol was, I think he's Muslim, and he's just praying. They pray every hour. And she says, okay. But that's not what it was. Right, Pastor?
There were, that's not what it was. No.
But I was always in either close to the front seat or behind the pastor. I wanted to be aware of what was going on. So I did see the smoke over the mountains, and I said, there's smoke there, but nobody said anything, because I don't think you guys wanted to scare us, right?
We were trying to keep it calm.
But I was keeping an eye on everything. So, but at the same time, I had so much faith and so much happiness that we were able to see everything that I wanted to see, like the tomb of Jesus, the Garden of Gethsemane, where he prayed and he sweated blood and all of that. So it's an amazing trip that just makes me feel like I was blessed, that God blessed me, that he wanted me to see that.
Yeah. The humor that came up through the stress was, it was pretty funny. It really was. Everything was funnier, which I think is probably due to some anxiety, but probably the funniest thing. Do you want to tell this one about the at Magdala, Mary?
Sure. So we were.
There you go.
So it was the first day that we heard things were happening, and the evening was wrapping up, and people had started to get messages from their family, and so Mary came up.
This is Mary Gold.
Yes.
Pastor Shad's wife.
Telling on her, but she came up to Zach and she said, okay, do I need to buy
my... No, first she said, are we going to be okay? Because I've never been through this before.
Okay, yeah. Yes.
Yeah, and then, I'm like, and bless her heart, she, you know, she's concerned.
She asked about a text, if something was true. She had heard from home, and so Zach said, yeah, that's true. And she goes, so do I need to go ahead and buy my nativity set here?
And for whatever reason, that's what I needed to hear at that very moment. Because it was like, that just changed the perspective entirely, you know. There was a moment, and we were like, you know, it kind of occurred to us, we're on the bus, and it was like, what have we done? You know, because you always have that cousin that says, y'all not go over to the Middle East, it's crazy over there, you know, and you're like, oh, it'll be fine. And when I tell everybody, oh, you're safer. Yeah, you're safer there than you are in Jacksonville, you know. And how many times have I said that? And they kept telling me, that's not true. And I said, guys, could you, is it okay? Can we have a moment of brevity? And they said, sure. And I said, okay, well, today only, because they're always telling you, special deal for you, today only. I'm going to make you a deal. I said, we're going to offer early signups for our next trip. we're going to go to the Ukraine for our next trip. What else?
Oh, I'm so thankful that we can laugh about it now, but at the time it was not. No, I had, of course, born and raised in church and always dreamt of going to the Holy Lands, and I never really thought it was a reality. And so it was Ed's dream, and so I was like, all right, let's do it. I've never been out of the country before, ever. Well, to the Bahamas, and that was it. But that was on a cruise ship. So I was very fearful, but I was like, okay, Lord, I'm trusting you. I'm trusting my husband wouldn't take me anywhere crazy. And so, I mean, it was safe, yeah. And Pastor Zach was like, it's safe. And I'm like, okay, Lord, Pastor Zach is going to be with us. And all of these amazing, we're good. So I was so proud of myself for getting through the plane ride. We got there and I was like, I can do anything. I was like, this is great. I can handle this. And so the first couple of days, just taking it all in was just, the Bible was coming to life, like right in front of my eyes. And I was just like, it was just crazy. And so... we're on the Sea of Galilee, and those of you that were here during VBS, I mean, like, every story that we taught in VBS was, like, coming to life, like, and I was just amazed, like, Jesus walked on this water, he calmed this water, they caught fish, and, like, it was just crazy. And so, of course, we get back on the bus, and we hear everything, and I look at it, and I was like, where have you brought me? Like, what have we done? And so, at that point, I was like, okay, he had no control over this. And so, it was just a lot of testing, and I was fearful. I'm not going to lie. I never thought I would have to download an app on my phone that tells me that a missile was coming. And my worst fear is going to a hotel and having a fire and not being able to get out. And we're having to make sure that we know where the bunker is so we can go. If the alarm is in at night, and oh my goodness, what am I going to put on? If the alarm goes off, and like, what do I grab? Like, and I'm so fearful about not having my passport with me and then not getting back home. And it was just so much fear. And then getting to Jerusalem and just the way, I mean, Flote was really good about doing that. It was like, wow, like we are in Jerusalem, you know? And then that night, just everything, just trusting, okay, Lord, like everything that I have believed my entire life, like is being put to the test right now. And I've preached it, I've taught it, I've said it, and I've claimed it, and I have to live it right now. And it was the worst fear that I've ever, like my biggest, greatest fear I was living. But I had the most peace I've ever felt in my life. And I just knew that it was gonna be okay. And we were in the Garden of Gethsemane, and that was to me the most powerful of it all. And Pastor Zach was like, you know, Jesus had a Gethsemane, and we never have to, because he had one. And so we got along with, you know, our spouses and just prayed, and like I saw the fear in his eyes, but then the belief that we were gonna be okay. And I knew, like he said, the worst thing that could happen to us is that we die. And that's not bad. Like, we won't even care when we get there. Like, it's gonna be so amazing. And I'm so thankful for that. And I promised the Lord that I would never stop telling our story, and that his faithfulness and his sovereignty and his guidance is true. And I'm so thankful that we have such amazing leaders in our church that continue to tell us that. And I knew that we were 100% perfect, according to Fode, because Pastor Zach was leading us 100%, and his leadership was coming from the Lord. And that's what was just so important. And when we landed the plane in Jacksonville, even New York, as much as I love New York City, I did not want to stay there. I was like, just get me to Jacksonville. And I was so thankful for all the prayers. And we felt it. We were up on this sixth floor of Jerusalem, overlooking Jerusalem the night when all of this was happening around us. And, you know, smoke and missiles and everything were overhead. And we were worshiping and we were praying. And that's what it's all about. And I'm just so thankful for that.
Yeah. Hello.
You're on.
Can you hear me? Hi, I'm Gina. Just wanted to say that, like Pastor Zach said, when we were there, the war was there, I felt very comfortable, and I just knew that God was with us, and we were praying a lot, and so I wasn't scared. And the only time I was scared was the very last night. I felt a little bit nervous at 2:30 in the morning when you could hear the missiles and the gunfire and things. That was the only time I was a little bit scared. But I could feel all the prayers. I knew that people were praying all over the place. We were hearing, you know, through social media and things. It wasn't until I got back to the States that, you know, I realized how difficult it was for our 21-year-old daughter. We had one daughter. And I didn't fully appreciate the stress that was on her and other members of our family and our friends back here. And when I went back to work, you know, there's like everybody talking, like, oh my gosh, you know, I've been praying for you. You know, thank God that you're safe. You know, how did you handle that? And I felt a real peace because it gave me so many opportunities to witness. Like, imagine if you don't have God in your heart, or you're not sure where you're going to go when you die. It causes a lot of anxiety and stress, and I didn't really feel that. And it just gave me more reason to want to share to others that, you know, Jesus is Lord. And I felt comfortable. I wasn't scared. And they're like, why? I'm like, because I knew where I was going. But for others that don't have that, it's just a reason why, one of the reasons maybe why we were there.
Amen. Amen.
One of the things that Martha and I experienced, Martha's my wife, she's not here. One of the things that also was shared on our trip was this stomach bug thing she's doing well now, but she decided she would stay home. But we were part of the second group that left to come back home. and so we were there, and it's like, okay, so what do you want to do? And so we said, let's walk down to the Dead Sea. We'd already been there the day before and floated in it, and you literally do float. And we said, okay, well, we'll float one more time. So we got in, and then when we got out and we were drying off, all of a sudden we heard this boom, 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 about 20 in a row of what we believed were missiles being fired or missiles landing somewhere. And we're standing there on the edge of the Red Sea listening to this and not feeling real good about it. We looked at each other and we said, okay, let's go back to our hotel room. And we did. And it just dawned on us that it was easy for us to shut it out of our minds because we could go back to the hotel room. But what about the people in Israel that are living this and they can't shut it out of their minds? They can't go to their hotel room and close the door. And it just really hit us about the devastation that was taking place. I just want to encourage all of us to continue to pray for the people of Israel and pray for peace. And the whole Palestinian issue is not an easy one. We just need to pray that God and the Lord will reign over that situation.
Yeah. Something that stood out to me, thankfully we did have a Christian guide, and he was telling us about friends he had in Gaza, some Christians. And so I just wanted to let you know that we have brothers and sisters in Gaza. And of course we do in Israel as well. And they're a minority in both of those places. But he was telling us that the Christians in Gaza have 2 times a year they're allowed to come to Israel to celebrate Christmas and Easter, because in Gaza they're not allowed to decorate or anything. And so it was just an interesting, such a sad and heartbreaking truth. But
we need to pray for them.
Yes.
Pray for our brothers.
Yes.
We're out of time. Sunday, I want to encourage you, be here. We're going to bring a word. We're going to take a break from Luke, and we're going to talk about what's going on in the Middle East. Everything is heightened. The passions are peaking. You wear a cross. You know, here in the States, that means nothing. You know, you might be the most wicked person in Nassau County and have a cross on your necklace. But there, they presume it means something. When we pray in Jesus' name. But we kind of tag it on at the end as a matter of habit. When you say Jesus over there, everybody hears you. And they want to talk to you about that. And at this moment in time, like never before, some of you guys encountered a little bit of hostility from some of the people over there that, you know, just recognized. I had one brother that had a Christian T-shirt on. You know, we see so many Christian T-shirts, we don't even see them anymore. Everybody just, that's just something we wear here around the church. But over there, people would see, you know, something about the cross, 3 nails saved my life or something like that. And they would come up and go, what does that mean? What do you mean by that? What are you saying about me? And they would get into a conflict over a T-shirt. And that something's brewing, that's what I'm trying to say. And wars and rumors of wars are spreading around this globe. And that means something. And you need to know what it means. And we're going to try to open God's word and show you what to do with it. So be here Sunday. This is a season for our church and a moment for our church. Invite people. Put it on Facebook. We're going to be promoting and pushing Sunday. Get here early, get a good spot, and we're going to preach from that moment. So let's leverage it for the kingdom and pray that people come to Jesus through it. And if you don't know him, there's no better time. And I'll say this, we're told in the Word of God that a day's coming when every knee will bow. Hamas will bow before Jesus. Israel will bow before Jesus. And you will bow before Jesus. Until then, amnesty is offered. Peace is offered. The psalmist said, kiss the Son while there is time, lest you perish in his wrath. There's time. Oh, there's time. Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart as they did in the wilderness. If you'll come unto him, as often as you come unto him, he will in no wise cast you out. I can say with every cell of my body, if you would be saved today, you can be saved today. He will have you. He will forgive you of everything. Today's the day of salvation. But I can give you no promise for tomorrow. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. I wonder if even here tonight, if somebody says, I'm not sure that I'm ready to meet my Maker. And I'm not sure that I have the peace that they were speaking of. And I sure would like to. From your heart, as I pray out loud, you might want to pray something like this. You can use your own words or you can use the ones that I give you, but you got to mean it. But from your heart, just pray to God. You can pray silently, but say, God, I know I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. And I do believe that Jesus came and he bore my sin on the cross and he paid for it. And when he cried out, it is finished, I believe that my sins were paid in full. I believe he died for my sins. And I believe that he was raised from the dead. He's alive today, and I trust that one day he's coming back. And I want to be ready. So, dear Lord, save me. Come into my heart. Give me new life. As you help me, I will follow you for the rest of my days. Thank you, Lord, for hearing this prayer and saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. See you Sunday. Get here early. God bless you.